Antichrist, suffering at the hands of Rome, 'cause they believe in Christ alone. They died through Europe, especially Spain, for they saw all but Christ is vain. He suffered by his death for men, to save them from their awful sin. 600 years of martyred saints that history cannot erase. With iron heel and iron hand, the Roman popes rule the land. Those ignorant of history may be swept into apostasy. We won't be lulled by Rome's sweet lie, with 50 million reasons why. Salvation is by faith alone, in Christ alone, by grace alone. A sovereign God give faith to man. Salvation's in the Maker's hand. This gospel offends Rome today. They offer up another way, a counterfeit, a compromise. Beware the ancient papal lie, with such a cloud of witnesses, who by grace died in their Lord. Recall their memory to say, by the same faith we live today.
Good evening. My name's Tom Press. I'm guest hosting for Walt on Walt's Mystery Babylon News Radio. And we'll continue where we left off last time in the reading of the book Romanism and the Reformation by Henry Grattan Guinness. And we will have 1 hour of reading and then a short break after that hour, and then a discussion by the listeners. And you're all welcome to ask questions and make comments as the Lord leads. And as is my custom, in order to preserve continuity, I'll back up a paragraph or two. And as a note, I feel in retrospect that maybe I was going a bit too fast with this portion of the book. So if you'll indulge me, I'll make a few appropriate comments as warranted by the text of the book. This is of particular importance to understand. We're talking about a period of time at the end of the old world order. The old world order came to an end at the Protestant Reformation. The old world order was characterized by a virtual global hegemony by the Pope, by the papacy. The Pope was the spiritual ruler of the world. You could not believe or teach anything contrary to the official teaching of the papacy. If you believed or taught anything contrary to the teachings of the Roman Catholic Church and the papacy, you were regarded as a heretic, and you were brought into the Inquisition and tortured to get you to recant. And if you did not recant of your heresy, you were summarily executed, oftentimes by burning at the stake. And not only was the papacy the ultimate so-called spiritual authority in the world, he was also the ultimate temporal authority. He governed the kings of the earth. The kings of the earth maintained their kingdoms at the pleasure of the papacy. And if they fell afoul of the Pope, somehow got into a disagreement or a quarrel with the Pope would issue sanctions or literally call other nations to war against that nation, to overthrow that government and to put in a ruler, a civil ruler, a king of the country that would obey the Pope. So essentially the Pope, or not essentially, practically speaking, in reality, the Pope had the position of King of Kings and Lord of Lords on the earth. That was the old world order. The old world order was toppled at the time of the Protestant Reformation, when the scriptures began to be read by the people in their own native tongue. The Bible was preserved by the Roman Catholic Church in Latin, and the people could not read it and were forbidden to read it. But the Spirit of God prevailed over the souls and the minds and the hearts of his people, and they translated the scriptures into the language of the people so that the people could read it for themselves rather than to be totally indoctrinated by the Roman Catholic Church, who picked and chose what it wanted to read from the scriptures and neglected the rest. So when the light of the gospel was returned to God's people, there was only one answer: rebellion against the papacy. As the gospel was read more and more by people and kings, it became apparent that the papacy was not the vicar or the replacement of Christ on earth. He was not the representative of Christ. He was Christ's antithesis, his enemy. And they labeled him Antichrist. The papacy was called Antichrist. And this is where the protest of the Protestant churches came about. They protested the Antichrist, the popes of Rome. Now, because of the Protestant Reformation and the growing belief and teaching that the papacy fulfilled the prophecies of the Bible regarding Antichrist, Rome had to do something, and do something drastic, and do something quick before she lost control of the whole world. And this is what we call the Counter-Reformation. The Counter-Reformation. It was a declaration of war against the Protestant reformers and against Protestantism. And it was led by the Jesuits, which was a militia that was created by Ignatius Loyola, subservient to the Roman Catholic Church, to stop the spread of Protestantism, to ultimately destroy Protestantism, and especially the belief that the papacy was the Antichrist of the Bible, and to raise the papacy back up to its old original status, King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the spiritual monarch of the world and the temporal monarch of the world. The Protestant reformers saw the scriptures that he was the Antichrist and that he was a tyrant, and he ruled over the consciences of men and taught them contrary to the scriptures. And as we continue the reading, this will be amply proven, and also enslaved the people through the governments over which the papacy ruled. So the people, God's people in particular, were oppressed in every way, spiritually and temporally. And liberty came when the Protestant Reformation came. And it was up to the Jesuits, the militia of the Pope, to reverse the loss that the papacy was suffering because of the Protestant Reformation. And that Counter-Reformation continues today, and it is still led by the Jesuit order, which has essentially, because of their futurist interpretation of the scripture, which says the papacy never was the Antichrist of the Bible, that the Protestant Reformation was a rebellion against the lawful and legitimate authority of Christ on earth, the papacy, and that not only should the Protestant Reformation be condemned as heresy, but that the Protestant world should make reparation and help to restore the papacy to its original hegemonic state. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. That is the new world order. There's nothing new about it at all. But then, of course, if they told the whole world that we want to reestablish the old world order, the Protestants would wake up. So they simply call it the New World Order, and they keep everybody ignorant about what it really is. But Henry Grattan Guinness, in this book, Romanism and the Reformation, is giving us enough information to realize that the New World Order that's spoken of today is, in fact, nothing else but the restoration of the Old World Order, to subject the entire world to the authority, both spiritually and temporally, to one man, the Antichrist of the Bible, the papacy. Now, Henry Grattan Guinness began to tell us about a creed that was written by Pope Pius IX at the time of the Council of Trent, the Jesuit-led Counter-Reformation Council of Trent. This was the declaration of war, the official public declaration of war by the Roman Catholic Church against Protestantism. Now, he begins on page 127, the first full paragraph, about a quarter of the way down. He says, "Perhaps I cannot give you a better idea of the distinctive teachings of Romanism as to controverted points of doctrine than by reading to you the creed of Pope Pius IV. This creed was adopted at the famous Council of Trent, held in the 16th century, when the doctrines of the Protestant Reformation were already widely diffused through Europe, and joyfully accepted and held by the young Protestant churches of many lands. The Council of Trent was indeed Rome's reply to the Reformation." That's what he says. The Council of Trent was indeed Rome or the Vatican's or the papacy's reply to the Protestant Reformation. This is Rome's answer to the Protestant Reformation. This is how Rome, the Roman Catholic Church, the Vatican, the papacy responded to the Protestant Reformation. And it's startling. He says the newly recovered truths of the gospel were in its canon laws and decrees stigmatized as pestilential heresies. Well, let me stop right here and comment. He says the newly recovered truths of the gospel. Why were they newly recovered? Well, because Rome had hid them in Latin. He'd hid the scriptures by making the Bible only written in Latin. The people couldn't read it for themselves, so the people were without the gospel. The only form of the gospel they got was what they got from the Latin-speaking priests. And guess what? The Church of Antichrist concealed the truths of the gospel and put all of the importance of the Christian life onto the Roman Catholic Church and onto the papacy. Whereas the scriptures puts all the power and authority on Christ and his people and liberates them from tyranny. So, because the Bible was now being translated into the languages of the people, they were able to read it for themselves, and they discovered that liberty. And they also discovered that the papacy was the Antichrist of the Bible. And they joyfully accepted the truth that they found in the scriptures. And these truths were held by the newly founded Protestant churches. And like I say, because of this Protestant understanding of the scriptures, newly recovered from Latin, now the people read it for themselves, they liberated themselves. They don't need a pope. They don't need the Roman Catholic Church. They don't need to confess their sins to a sinful pedophile priest. They don't need to eat the Jesus cookie. Jesus rules at the right hand of God in heaven. He's not worshipped through images and idols or a piece of bread or a cup of wine or any such thing. And Rome was literally losing control. The old world order was crumbling around the Pope's papal tiara. And it spelled doom for the Roman Catholic Church and for the papacy and for a global reign of the Pope, the New World Order. Something had to be done, and Rome immediately replied to those pestilential Protestant reformers. It says the newly recovered truths of the gospel were in its, that is, the Roman Catholic Church's canons and decrees, stigmatized as pestilential heresies, and all who held them accursed. That's right. The Council of Trent was determined to meet and to stigmatize all of the teachings of the Protestant reformers as heresies and damnable heresies, and sentencing them all to excommunication from the church and eternal damnation in hell. That was the purpose of convening the Council of Trent. And it says, and in opposition to them, this creed was prepared and adopted. This creed by Pope Pius IV. This was adopted. It was written by Pope Pius IV and his advisors, Jesuit advisors, no doubt. And it was presented to the Council of Trent to be formally adopted by the Ecumenical Council of the Church, so that it became, at that point, canon law, as if God had spoken, and it must be assented to by every Roman Catholic. And from the papacy's point of view, it had to be assented to by every Christian, including the Protestants. Now he continues, he says, it commences with the Nicene Creed, which is common to Romanists and Protestants, but to this simple and ancient form of sound words, it adds 12 new articles which are peculiar to Rome and contain her definite rejection of the doctrines of Scripture recovered at the Protestant Reformation. So not only does it contain the Nicene Creed, but then it adds 12 new articles. And you'll know by reading and understanding these that this is a formal declaration of war to the death between from the Roman Catholic Church against the Protestants. Now, here are those 12 points. Number one, this is Pope Pius IV speaking or writing, and this is being presented to the Ecumenical Council of the Vatican, the College of Bishops, according to the papacy, all of Christendom. Okay, these are the statements that were officially adopted by this council and became Roman Catholic canon law. And if you listen carefully, if you understand your Bible, if you understand the gospel of Christ, you will find nothing but tyranny and anti-Protestant language in the tenets of this creed. Number one, I most firmly admit and embrace apostolical and ecclesiastical traditions and all other constitutions and observances of the same church. Okay, notice no mention of the gospel. He firmly admits or establishes as dogma of the church the apostolical and ecclesiastical traditions. Now, the Roman Catholic Church teaches that not only do we have the written word of God to govern us, but we have oral traditions of the apostles and of the early ecclesiastics of the church. And they too are equal, if not superior, to the written word of God. This is uniquely Roman Catholic, and he is stating this as a tenet of Christendom, in order to, in a sense, condemn the Protestants who teach sola scriptura, the scripture only. We're not going to accept any longer these so-called traditions that Rome says has been passed down from the apostles through the Roman Catholic Church fathers, and these traditions are typically where we get image and idol worship, Mary worship, priestly celibacy, purgatory, the rosary, and all these other extra-biblical beliefs and practices of the Roman Catholic Church that are, in fact, denounced by the Scriptures and forbidden by God's holy law. These so-called traditions are held equal, if not superior, status to the written word of God. And it was the Protestant reformers who condemned these so-called traditions, these apostolical and ecclesiastical traditions of the Roman Catholic Church, as heresies, as anti-Christian teaching. So Rome answers the Protestants by saying, we admit and we embrace these apostolical and ecclesiastical traditions. In other words, we're going to stand our ground, and we're going to make this the law of the world, these traditions, as are practiced and observed and handed down from the Roman Catholic Church. Okay, number two. Again, Pope Pius IV speaking at the Council of Trent. He says, I also admit the sacred scriptures according to the sense which the Holy Mother Church has held and does hold, to whom it belongs to judge of the true sense and the interpretation of the Holy Scriptures. Nor will I ever take or interpret them otherwise than according to the unanimous consent of the Fathers. Now, in this second article, Pope Pius IV declares that the sacred scriptures, that is the Bible as we know it, is to be believed according to the sense and the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church, whose purpose it is, whose responsibility, whose sole responsibility it is to read, interpret, and to judge the sense, the true sense of the scriptures. What this is saying in laborious language is the Roman Catholic Church is going to remain the ecclesiastical authority of the world. We're going to be the sole dispensers of the gospel. We're going to interpret it according to the sense that we see in the scriptures. And we're going to impose it on you as such. And you will be held according to Roman Catholic canon law under pain of excommunication and heresy to believe exactly the way the Roman Catholic Church teaches, no matter what your conscience tells you, no matter what you think you read in the scriptures, you will believe the way Holy Mother Church tells you to believe. And that's Roman Catholic canon law. Remember, all these decrees of this creed were passed by the Council of Trent. And it's, as already you can see, this is a direct personal attack against Protestantism. Now, number three, I profess also that there are truly and properly seven sacraments of the new law instituted by Jesus Christ our Lord and for the salvation of mankind, though all are not necessary for everyone, namely baptism, confirmation, Eucharist, penance, extreme unction, orders, and matrimony, and that they confer grace. Listen to that one. They confer grace. In other words, you obtain grace by participating in these seven sacraments of the Roman Catholic Church. And he says further, and of these, baptism, confirmation, and orders cannot be reiterated without sacrilege. In other words, if you recant from the baptism that you obtained in the Roman Catholic Church and wish to join a Protestant church and be fully immersed in biblical baptism, then you've committed a sacrilege because you have, in a sense, defamed the baptism that you received in the Roman Catholic Church. According to the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church, it is the Roman Catholic Church and the Roman Catholic Church only who can baptize. If you're baptized anywhere else, you're not baptized. You've just been dunked, okay? The Roman Catholic Church teaches that baptism is spiritual regeneration, and that is to be practiced as soon after birth as possible. You are to bring your baby just as quickly as possible after delivery to the priest to have it baptized by the Roman Catholic priest in a Roman Catholic church. And if your baby dies before it is baptized, it has not been spiritually regenerated, and it must go to a place called limbo. Okay? The salvation of a baby who dies before baptism cannot be assured by the Roman Catholic Church, and they had to create a place called limbo for the babies who died before baptism. It's a ghastly religion. All right. We're talking about sacraments here. In the body of Christ, the true body of Christ, there is the sacrament of communion, okay? The Lord's Supper, and also baptism by immersion. Those were the two commandments that the Lord left us, the two sacraments, if that's what you care to call them. I don't use Rome's terms. I call them ordinances. These are the things God left us. These are the things that Christ left us to practice. Baptism and the elements of communion. Okay? Rome has added to this, as is typical of Rome, to set herself apart from Christ. Okay, and these are namely called, these, in addition to baptism and communion, they're called confirmation, penance, extreme unction, orders, matrimony. Listen, I could laboriously comment about every one of these. I just want you to know that confirmation was not given to us by Christ. Neither was this idea, this most diabolical idea of the Eucharist, where the bread and wine of communion are elevated by the priest in the ceremony of the Mass, and after five magic Latin words, it is believed on pain of excommunication in the Roman Catholic Church that the priest changes the substance of the communion wafer and the wine to the literal blood, body, soul, and divinity of Christ, and that as Christ, it is again crucified once again on the altar of the Roman Catholic Church. So the Eucharist is a sacrifice, a bloodless sacrifice, they call it, and through the practice of the Mass, the sacrifice of the Mass, grace is earned. So if you go to the Roman Catholic Church, you participate in the sacrament of the Eucharist, you have more grace than you did before. And this is totally contrary to the teachings of Scripture, and it's one of the most visible marks of the true character of the Roman Catholic Church, an Antichrist church. Confirmation, even some Protestant churches perform what is known as confirmation after a period of education from the Scriptures. They are tested and then confirmed in the church. These things are still practiced even in the Protestant churches, but they are not sacraments. They are not orders or ordinances given down to us from Christ. They are extra-biblical. Also, penance. Penance is the notion in the Roman Catholic Church that you must make reparation for your sins. After confessing your sins to a priest, the priest issues a penance. Maybe that might be like in the case of Martin Luther, you have to ascend and descend so many times up a flight of stone stairs on your bare knees until the blood runs forth, to make payment for your sins. You have to literally pay for your sins. Now, you can do it with works, or you can do it with money, or any other demand that the priest makes. And oftentimes, it was a demand, especially if it happened to be a king of a country, to exterminate or annihilate all the so-called heretics, the Bible-believing Christians, out of your country. That's the penance that is issued by the priest after once hearing your confessions of your sins and that is nowhere taught in the scriptures. Quite the contrary. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But Rome can't make any money under that law, so they make penance. And she gets rich in the process. Here's another one, extreme unction. This is the requirement of the Roman Catholic Church that at the time of death, the penitent must make one last confession and they must be blessed by the priest in order to secure his place in purgatory or to guarantee him to go to heaven, especially if he gives them all of his farm and all of his children and all of his wealth and everything else. See, you buy your way to heaven in the Roman Catholic Church. Extreme unction is a requirement of the Roman Catholic Church that the last person a dying man sees before he dies is a Roman Catholic priest. In order to make one last plea for financial support, extreme unction. And this extreme unction is so important in the Roman Catholic Church. Remember, it's a sacrament that it became a requirement in the United States military to have dog tags that state the religious affiliation of every soldier. And that's so that Roman Catholics who are nearing death on the battlefield, a priest can be summoned to their side to extort whatever he can. Okay, that's Rome's system. It's an Antichrist system. Here's another sacrament of the Roman Catholic Church. It's called orders, sometimes called holy orders. Not everyone is required to join one of these holy orders like the Franciscans or the Dominicans or the Gregorians or hundreds of other orders of the Roman Catholic Church. So, secret societies, diabolical from stem to stern, and simply one of the control mechanisms of the Roman Catholic Church. The diabolical practices in the monasteries of these so-called orders are monumental, biblical proportions, unbelievable criminality in these so-called holy orders of the Roman Catholic Church. Now, here's the one I'd like to talk about the most. The sacrament of matrimony. Did you know that the Roman Catholic Church claims to be the only authority on the earth where a valid marriage can take place? It has to be in a Roman Catholic Church by a Roman Catholic priest in good standing with the church. If you're married outside of the Roman Catholic Church, you are living in filthy concubinage, according to Roman Catholic canon law. And if you are married outside of the Roman Catholic Church, you have to obtain a license to get married. There's Peter's Pence again. You have to pay money. You have to get permission to commit this sacrilege of being married outside the Roman Catholic Church. The Roman Catholic Church claims sole dominion over marriage. No one else can lawfully marry another man and woman. Now, where does that leave Christ? And first of all, did Adam and Eve have to get a license from the Roman Catholic Church to get married? How about Abraham? How about anybody before the Roman Catholic Church attributed to itself sole jurisdiction over marriage? You see, you only need a license to do that which is unlawful. Roman Catholic Church says that if you are married outside of the Roman Catholic Church, you have committed a crime. It is unlawful to be married outside the Roman Catholic Church. Therefore, you must obtain a license first. And the state is the one who issues that license. But remember, the state is the servant of the Roman Catholic Church. And that's why they require us to pay license fees to get married if we're going to be married outside of the Roman Catholic Church. I bet you didn't know that, did you? Now, all of these so-called sacraments of the Roman Catholic Church If you participate in them, in each one, grace is conferred to you. It's not a free gift in the Roman Catholic Church as it is in God's kingdom, Christ's kingdom. Grace is a gift of God in the kingdom of Christ. In the kingdom of Antichrist, grace is earned. You have to earn it, and it's expensive. And it's never ultimate. At no time in a Christian, in a so-called Roman Catholic man's life, is he ever guaranteed that he'll go to heaven. Even after death, writhing in the flames of purgatory, no priest can tell you how long the sentence in purgatory will last and when you'll be sprung from purgatory, and then you can enter the pearly gates of heaven. With, of course, Peter, the so-called Apostle Peter, that is the papacy, standing at the doorway of heaven to make sure that you can go in. St. Peter. And that's the papacy. The papacy claims to be the succession of Peter. So, you can see, even by this third tenet, that this is a direct attack against Protestantism, and not just Protestantism, against the Bible. Every one of these things are a direct attack against the Scriptures. It's a direct attack against Christ, and that's what makes it the Church of Antichrist. Number four, I also receive and admit the ceremonies of the Roman Catholic Church, received and approved in solemn administration of all the above said sacraments. Okay? All the ceremonies, the pomp and circumstance, all of the official authority of the Roman Catholic Church. Number five, I receive and embrace all and every one of the things which have been defined and declared in the Holy Council of Trent concerning original sin and justification. See, in the Protestant churches, in the kingdom of Christ, we are justified by faith. In the Roman Catholic Church, in the Council of Trent, we are justified by works. Okay? So, again, this is an attack upon the gospel and therefore an attack against Protestantism. Number six, I profess likewise that in the Mass is offered to God a true, proper, and propitiatory sacrifice for the living and for the dead, and that in the most holy sacrifice of the Eucharist there is truly, really, and substantially the body and blood, together with the soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that there is made a conversion of the whole substance of the bread into the body, and of the whole substance of the wine into the blood, which conversion the Roman Catholic Church calls transubstantiation. The changing of substance, that's what transubstantiation means. This, the Protestant churches renounced as blasphemy. That the priest of the Roman Catholic Church can somehow turn bread and wine into the literal blood, body, soul, and divinity of Christ, that the priest can, in effect, create his creator in the Mass, or literally yank Jesus Christ off of the throne at the right hand of the Father, bringing down and slamming him into this bread and wine, and then sacrifice him again on the altar of the Roman Catholic Church. In the Bible, and in the Protestant churches, this is the ultimate insult of Christ and the gospel. And this is what repulsed the Protestant reformers once they'd read the gospel for themselves. They renounced the Eucharist, they renounced the Mass, and they renounced the Roman Catholic Church as the synagogue of Satan. And it is, literally. Number seven. I confess also that under either kind alone, whole and entire Christ and a true sacrament are received. So if there's only bread or there's only wine in the Mass, for some reason they run out of Jesus cookies, or it was a bad year and they don't have any wine, that's no big deal. It's still Jesus, and it's still a sacrifice, and it's still a propitiatory sacrifice. It pays for sins, okay? It redeems us to God. It reconciles us to God. That's the teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. And again, the Protestant reformers denounced all this as abject heresy and blasphemy, which it is. Number eight, I constantly hold that there is a purgatory and that the souls detained therein are helped by the suffrages of the faithful. In other words, the works of the faithful. You ever see the videos on television of Roman Catholic fanatics in the Philippines running through the strip, running through the streets, stripped, bare naked in many cases, and in other cases a simple loincloth covering their privates, and they whip their bodies, their backs, in parade up and down the street until the blood runs from their backs. These Roman Catholic people believe that they are punishing themselves for their sins. And if they whip themselves long enough and bloody enough, they not only make propitiation for their own sins, but they can pay for the sins of those who are writhing in the flames of purgatory and therefore spring them early from purgatory so that they can go to heaven. This is constantly taught in the Roman Catholic Church, that sacrifices may be made for the dead, that prayers may be made on behalf of the dead in purgatory, that inflicting torturous pain on oneself can pay for sins of those writhing in the flames of purgatory. Can you see the slavery of all this? Can you see Jesus Christ doing nothing but condemning this as a trick of Satan to deceive his people, to make them think that they could even pay for their own sins? Look, if a man could pay for his own sins, then Christ died in vain, didn't he? That's what's really taught in the Roman Catholic Church, that Christ died in vain, that the Roman Catholic system reduces Christ to vanity. This is the official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church, adopted as canon law in the most historically significant general council of the Roman Catholic Church, the Council of Trent, the bloody Counter-Reformation Council of Trent led by the Jesuits. Number nine, likewise, that the saints reigning together with Christ are to be honored and invocated, that they offer prayers to God for us, and that their relics are to be venerated. Okay? Now, let me reiterate what I said in an earlier program. According to Roman Catholic canon law, no one is a saint until after he dies, and then the Roman Catholic Church can examine his life and determine whether or not to elevate him to sainthood. Then, once the Roman Catholic Church or the papacy declares a certain individual, a dead person, to be a saint, then they may be prayed to, and they may be these dead saints, once they are canonized by the Roman Catholic Church as saints, then they have the power to pray for us to God. Yes, the dead can save the living in the Roman Catholic Church, when the Bible clearly forbids God's people to consult the dead. This is Antichrist teaching. It was condemned by the Protestant reformers, but it was reiterated at the most important council in the history of the Roman Catholic Church, the Council of Trent, the Counter-Reformation Council of Trent. Now, these dead saints are to be prayed to to be venerated, to be honored, and celebrate their lives and celebrate their birthdays and celebrate their martyrdoms in whichever case they may be. And also statues may be made of them, and people may pray to them and offer gifts to these statues. And is any of this biblical? No, it's contra-biblical. It's all from literature. Number 10, I most firmly assert that the images of Christ and of the Mother of God, the Mother of God, ever virgin, and also the other saints are to be had and retained, and that due honor and veneration are to be given them. Okay. First of all, they regard Mary, not the mother of Jesus, but the mother of God. That makes her equal to or superior to God. And that's where we get Mariolatry. This is what is taught by the so-called fathers of the Roman Catholic Church. This is part of the extra-biblical traditions that are held to be even higher than Scripture among the Roman Catholic Church. He says, I most firmly assert that the images, the statues, the paintings, and all the other forbidden imagery and idolatry of the Roman Catholic Church, those images of Christ and the images of his mother, ever virgin, remember now the Roman Catholic Church believes she was perpetually a virgin. Even though she gave birth to Jesus, she remains a virgin. And that elevates her to God's status. That's why they worship the images of Mary. They pray to Mary. They pray to apparitions of Mary. Demonic manifestations known as familiar spirits posing as Mary. And everything she says is written down as though it were the voice of God, and everybody venerates Mary. You're going to see this more and more and more in the ecumenical evangelical churches. And also the other saints are to be had and retained, and that due honor and veneration are to be given them. And Paul said, little children, keep you from idols. Again, this is the counter-reformation. This is counter-Christianity. This is straight from the pit. It is what it is because it is what it is. The Church of Antichrist, the synagogue of Satan. Number 11, I also affirm that the power of indulgences was left by Christ in the church, and that the use of them is most wholesome to Christian people. Indulgences. This is the bank that I was telling you about before, where the virtues of Mary were sufficient, not only enough to save her soul, but to save those in purgatory. And the extra grace that was earned by the Virgin Mary in giving birth to Jesus are stored away in this bank, and the Pope's got a key to it. And whenever he wishes, if you pay enough money to the church, he can take his little key and open that spiritual bank of graces, and he can make a withdrawal from the excess savings account of Mary and attribute it to you. And they can even, you can even, with money or works for the church, you can be forgiven of your past sins and you can be forgiven of future sins. So if you were planning on robbing a bank or killing somebody, and you didn't want to go to purgatory for it, you could go to the priest and ask for an indulgence. And the priest would say, well, what kind of an indulgence and how much are you willing to pay? And so, well, it's I'm going to get even with one of my business partners that stiffed me on a deal, and I'm going to make it lucrative for the church. Here's $1,000. And the priest gives you an indulgence, and you may commit any sin up to and including murder for a period existing, for a period to end, well, whenever determined, a month, 2 months, a year, or the rest of your life, depending on how much money you paid. You can commit any sin for money. That's indulgences. As a matter of fact, the last pope, Pope Benedict XVI, reinstituted indulgences, the very thing the very thing that started the Protestant Reformation. This is when the so-called reformers of the Roman Catholic Church had had enough. The Roman Catholic Church, in order to raise money to build the new cathedral in St. Peter's Basilica, in the Vatican called St. Peter's Basilica, was going to take millions and millions and millions of dollars. And so the Roman Catholic Church went around peddling these indulgences. That's how they raised money for that, the biggest church in the world, the most luxurious, the most opulent church in the world was raised by indulgences, people buying permission to sin. It's a lucrative deal. That's why the Roman Catholic Church is the most wealthy institution on the planet. Number 12, I acknowledge the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Roman Church, the mother and mistress of all churches. Don't miss this. The mother and mistress of all churches. What does the Bible call her? The mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. Rome admits it right here in the Council of Trent by Pope Pius IV. Listen to what he says. I acknowledge the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Roman Church, the mother and mistress of all churches, and I promise and swear true obedience to the Roman bishop, that's the Pope, the successor of St. Peter, the prince of the apostles, and vicar of Jesus Christ. And vicar means replacement of Jesus Christ. Blasphemy of blasphemies, right there in the writing of Pope Pius IV, officially sanctioned and adopted by the Counter-Reformation Council of Trent, literally declaring it the synagogue of Satan. And it just still stifles me every time that I suggest that the papacy is the Antichrist of the Bible. The incredulity that comes over people's faces, like I've somehow grown two heads right before their very eyes. And this is all researchable stuff. This is official teaching of the Roman Catholic Church. It's Roman Catholic canon law. And it's the law of the land in most of the world today. Remember, the New World Order is simply the Old World Order restored. This is what is to be believed and taught by all quote-unquote Christians of the New World Order. I acknowledge the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Roman Church, the mother and mistress of all churches, and I promise and swear true obedience to the Roman bishop, the successor of St. Peter, the prince of the apostles, and vicar of Jesus Christ. That's the Pope. The man of sin, son of perdition, just like the Bible describes. Who would dare call himself the vicar of Jesus Christ? What flesh and blood man in all the world's history would dare, would have the audacity, the brazen audacity, the diabolical audacity to call himself the replacement of Jesus Christ on the earth? But that's the papacy's official title. It has always been the papacy's official title. And that's why the Protestant reformers recognized him for who he was after they read the scripture. That's why the Waldenses, the Huguenots, the Hussites, the Lombards, all of them knew that the papacy was the Antichrist long before the Protestant Reformation. And it's only in our generation that we're ignorant of this fact. Well, it's time for us to put away our ignorance and to call the papacy what it is and to bring the world's attention to the real man of sin and the son of perdition in this world and condemn the governments of this world for kowtowing to him and bringing us under the servitude and slavery and tyranny of the man of sin in Rome. Number 13, I also profess and undoubtedly receive all other things delivered, defined, and declared by the sacred canons and general councils, and particularly by the Holy Council of Trent. And I also condemn, reject, and anathematize all things contrary thereto, and all heresies whatsoever condemned, rejected, and anathematized by the church. In other words, Every Roman Catholic must bind himself spiritually without any mental or purpose, any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, to accept as the voice of God everything accepted by the Council of Trent and the papacy. Continuing, it says, this true Catholic faith out of which none can be saved, that's right, officially in the Roman Catholic Church, if you're outside of it, you cannot be saved. This true Catholic faith out of which none can be saved, which I now freely profess and truly hold, I, and then give your name, promise, vow, and swear most constantly to hold and profess the same whole and entire with God's assistance to the end of my life, and to procure as far as lies in my power that the same shall be held, taught, and preached by all who are under me or are entrusted to my care by virtue of my office. So help me God and these holy gospels of God. Unquote. So there you have it, the creed of Pope Pius IV. Antichrist, Pope Pius IV. And every Roman Catholic must concede to this on pain of excommunication and eternal damnation. That includes every God-fearing, Bible-believing man of God. Everyone in the body of Christ is condemned by the Roman Catholic Church as a heretic. This creed of Pope Pius IV is the authoritative papal epitome of the canons and decrees of the Council of Trent. The importance of this council, quote, depends upon the considerations that its records embody the solemn, formal, and official decision of the Roman Catholic Church, which claims to be the one holy Catholic Church of Christ upon all the leading doctrines taught by the Reformers, that its decrees upon all doctrinal points are received by all Romanists as possessed of infallible authority, and that every popish priest is sworn to receive, profess, and maintain everything defined and declared by it. Unquote. As an illustration of its reception and maintenance in the present day by the infallible head of the Romish Church and by the whole conclave of Roman Catholic bishops, I refer you to their action in the comparatively recent Council of Vatican, that is Vatican Council I of 1870, about the time of the writing of this book. He says, see the almost incredible spectacle of 1870. See those 700 bishops of the church throughout the world gathered at Rome at the high altar at St. Peter's. See them and hear them. In this Romish book entitled The Chair of Peter, page 497, is a description of the scene. Quote, the Pope recited in a loud voice the profession of faith, namely the Creed of Nice and Constantinople, together with the definitions of the Council of Trent, called the Creed of Pope Pius IV, after which it was read aloud from the ambo by the Bishop of Fabriano, then for two whole hours, to use the words of one of the prelates present, quote, the cardinals, patriarchs, primates, archbishops, bishops, and other fathers of the council made their adhesion to the same by kissing the gospel at the throne of the head of the church, unquote. A truly sublime spectacle. Those 700 bishops from all parts of the earth, the representatives of more than 30 nations and of 200 millions of Christians, thus openly making profession of one common faith in communion with the one and supreme pastor and teacher of all, unquote. That's right. They regard the papacy as the voice of God on the earth, the supreme pastor of every man, woman, and child on the planet, regardless of religious affiliation. And not only that, but he's the sole teaching authority in the world. No one else has authority to teach children or anyone else but the papacy. And if one is in a position of teaching in this country without the blessing of the papacy, he's a heretic. Okay? That means that the official Department of Education in the federal government of this country that establishes the curriculum and the syllabus, the envelope of studies, all the sciences, the arts, all of it has to go through approval by the Roman authority in the government, that nothing may be taught in the schools that is not approved by the Roman Catholic Church. And that's a matter of Roman Catholic canon law. And whether you want to believe it or not, the government of the United States does not respond to the will and demand of the people of this country, despite all of its claims. It responds to the papacy, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the God of this world, the biblical, historical, and prophetic Antichrist of the Scripture. And with the cooperation of our federal government, our education system, with the cooperation of the seminaries, we are all held ignorant of all the history that I've just read you. Many of you listening for the first time of your life you're hearing these things. The true teachings of the Roman Catholic Church, they've been held secret from you. And you have to admit that they had a whole lot of cooperation from a whole lot of people that we depend on to keep this information secret. And you've got to ask yourself, as ignorant as I am of these facts, who in this country can I trust? It should be no surprise to you that the papacy is the Antichrist of the Bible. It wasn't a surprise to the Protestant reformers, nor was it to any Bible-believing Christian before the Protestant Reformation. The Antichrist has been with us all along, killing God's people and covering up her crimes, and now is in the process of restoring all former things, and they call it new. That's the end of the first hour. I'll take a short break. We'll come back and have some discussion, and I'll turn it over to Walt. And by the way, if you would like to contact me with a comment or question, you may do so at tom@cwaves.us, tom@cwaves.us. Also listen to Inquisition Update, my daily program on firstamendmentradio.com, www.firstamendmentradio.com. I come on for an hour at 10 a.m. Central Time every day, Monday through Friday. And thanks for listening. I'll see you in just a few minutes. Over to you.